So how do we rethink what we think privacy?
That's what our topic, topic is about, that privacy is one thing that is super important and how we can take care of it. So as you see, more and more companies are deploying the ML and DL models. There are a lot of models coming in production. The thing is, a lot of data that is being used for this are crowdsourced. And even after, our basic attempts to de-identify the personal details of people, it's still present. So what happens is, basically, high dimensional data with a lot of features is actually quite unique. And higher the number of features, it is the easier it is to identify the person whose data it is. Because if you have a lot of features, it will be easier to find out which person or which group it can be. So, yeah. If you see, high dimensional and high resolution data is essentially unique. So if you find that, someone whose office is in London, working in IT department, the date of joining is this, the salary is some X, date of birth is this, and more the dimension, if you see, it's easier for me to actually, drill down and find out which person this might be. With lower data, lower dimension or lower resolution, if we are aggregating something, it is more private because it's difficult to, find out a person. But again, it's less useful because the model accuracy will decrease because of this aggregation. So where is privacy needed? Like medical records, genetic data, search history. If you think of it, perhaps everywhere. Like privacy is important in each and every sector or use case that we talk about. So we'll talk about a few of the breaches that was there, the biggest breaches. So AOL, for that matter, in August 2006, for research purposes, released the search data for a lot of customers. And then what happened, it was an intention. What happened is, though they did not identify the person in the report and there were numeric representation for each person, what happened is New York Times was actually able to locate an individual by cross-referring all those details with the phone book listing. So what is happening is, there's one data set, you think it is private because you have removed a few of the details, and only considering your data set, it's difficult to find out the person. But there may be other data set which in used together can actually give a lot more information than you can even think of, especially in case where a lot of companies use crowdsourced and open data. So AOL's breach was one of the most known. Then was Netflix. So Netflix was aware of the privacy laws. There was no consent from the users that will be viewing your records. And then what happens is, so there was this challenge, there was a Netflix challenge. So you were given ratings by some users and you were predicting what will be their rating for another movie, for the recommendation systems or whatever. Though the users were anonymized, some users on the data set were identified using the data set from IMDb. And again, it was, for some of the users, it was exactly known that which user was that person in the challenge. So that was another instance of it. Then we are thinking of what are the possible ways to release them, what are the possible ways to release the data. So one is you can perhaps use the trusted party use data to learn their classifier or general studies or general statistics. So you are giving your data to a trusted party. The second way can be you can only give out the general statistics. The third way is you release the classifier which you learned on your own data, and rather than releasing the data, you're just releasing the classifier. And now we'll see if even these are secure or not. So, if you think rather than giving out raw data, if you give this, will this make things, really private? Let's see that. So in the first case, let's imagine for the illustration that Alice is one of the users. Bob is, the deep learning engineer maybe who is using Alice's data to train his model. And Eve is one party who is trying to recover or reconstruct the data as provided by Alice, which was, which was shared by Bob. So, the first case was, only allow trusted party use the data to learn classifiers or general statistics. So in this first case, Bob may share a data set to allow others to train their model. So again, with Bob sharing it, there is a possibility of them to, you know, again, use it with several other data and then maybe finding it. So if you think of it, it's really not, you know, completely private, similar to what was there in the Netflix challenge as well. The second thing can be, you know, releasing only the general statistics. But so what can happen is Bob may now share only the neural network weights of a model that he himself trained on the data. If can find out if Alice, the data provider maybe, is included in the database by looking at the weight put on a particular feature. So if even if you're releasing just the weight, they can look at the weight for the feature, and you know if it is known to be characteristic to Alice. For example, consider Alice rated a movie that very few people have watched. Now the weightage of that feature would be significantly different with and without Alice in that data. So yeah, so again there are ways to find it. It's not really private. So if you know one thing about Alice that you know she has watched this movie, there's a lot you can find out about it. The third way maybe is, you know, only the classifier learned from the data is released. So this is perhaps one of the like the most conservative out of these three ways. Bob may, you know, just only allow third parties to query an API that provides an output of a model that he has trained on the data himself. But even then, as it turns out, you know, all these three ways of sharing data is not really, you know, very, very private, and it still has the potential to expose Alice's data. So that's what brings us to, you know, a concept of technology called differential privacy that we'll talk about.
So once again, when we look at privacy, we need to familiarize ourselves with the fact that this is our holy privacy trinity, and you can't have all three. You can, at the max, choose two. So you can either, you can't have privacy, a good data size, and accuracy together. Because sometimes we have privacy expectations, saying that, you know, I want it to be private, but I want it to be private for free. And that's wrong. You can't have that. When you do a privatization, it requires removing at least a small amount of information. And the second thing that we say is that, oh, you know, I could probably have absolute privacy. Again, that is a myth. You cannot have absolute privacy. And if you do have absolute privacy, you would also be unable to distinguish between two different data points. But the reasonable privacy expectations that we can have is that our privacy model should have a tuning that, okay, I can choose how much I can have a balance between accuracy and privacy loss. It should be plausible it can be plausible, you can have plausible deniability. Means the presence of a data point in the database should not be able to be ascertain. Means you cannot say that this particular person is 100% present in the database or not. And you can prevent targeted attacks. These are reasonable privacy expectations. So when we talk about what is differential privacy, the person who came up with this concept said that you will not be affected if your data is used in a particular survey or any data collection mechanism. That's the main, that's the core principle that he wanted behind differential privacy. We can go through the textbook definition, but you know, it's just a lot of really difficult words. So hypothetically, if I take two and X is trained on the full training corpus, whereas Y has the full training corpus excluding one data point. In an ideal situation, what would happen is X and Y would be the same. Like you wouldn't have that much influence of a single data point. That is what you would think. However, the reality is not so nice. We do not live in ideal situations. And the more that single data point had the more these two differ. And the more there is a chance for a privacy leakage. So if a single entry doesn't change the result at all, and if when I say a single entry, I mean every single entry, then it is 100% differentially private. Of course, that would make it pretty useless. No offense. Okay, let's go back to Bob, Alice, and Ian. So what Bob does is Bob says that I will introduce Alice's data and I will introduce some sort of noise. Now, when Eve tries to reconstruct, Eve does not know if that is Alice's data or if it is noise. If we go back to the Netflix challenge, which is something like a baseline example here, Eve would not know if that particular rating is the actual rating that Alice would have given, or if there is some noise that is introduced by Bob. Okay, but when you do this, that you would say that, oh, this affects the accuracy. And that's the real subtle art of differential privacy, is that you inject noise in a way that you are able to compensate for it. Okay, so this is like the formal definition of differential privacy. I thought, yeah, once you do a talk about differential privacy, you need to have that formula somewhere. I'll just roughly touch upon it. So if you have an input space X and an output space Y, privacy parameter epsilon is what is the main differential privacy parameter. And if epsilon is 0, it means that you have perfect privacy. Trust me, that's not a good thing. You also have a pretty, not a very useful data. So epsilon 0 is perfect privacy, and epsilon is unconstrained. You could have like a really, really, really not private database. Another thing that we also should talk about is approximate differential privacy, where there's an additional parameter delta. And this variant was introduced by DeWalt, where basically what it means to say is delta is the possibility with which the with privacy being broken. It means finding out that it is Alice's data is delta. And you preferably want it to be less than 1 by n, where n is your input size. This is the main important part that we need to talk about, is where do you insert noise in ML or DL models? So the places where your noise could be injected is the feature data set layer, or you could inject it during the model training as part of backpropagation's SGD, or you could inject noise at the activation output of the model layers. Now, when you inject noise, it has to be done intelligently to balance the considerations for algorithm performance and the calibration of noise properties. So basically, this is the subtle art of differential privacy implementation, is finding a balance between privacy and utility. So this is an interesting concept that is mostly still in academic research. We have generative adversarial networks, GANs, as most of you might know. The theory that they say is that, you know, why do you even want a database that means a data set that has private, has any information for that matter? Let's create a synthetic replacement of the data set via a GAN, which has characteristic features that are similar to the underlying data, but no particular data that can be personally identifiable. Since you create another complete data set that has the same features as your current data set, but it does not have that personally identifiable network. differential privacy acts like a privacy barrier between your private data set and what you release to the public. Now, why is differential privacy so useful for deep learning? It is major properties that differential privacy has, which is composability, and that enables you to have modular designs, group privacy, which ensures you have graceful degradation, and robustness to auxiliary information. When you do want to design a differentially private additive noise, you need to follow these three steps, which is: first, you approximate the functionality, then you choose the parameters of your additive noise, and you perform privacy analysis. The third one is very important. A quick touch upon TensorFlow's differentially private model, and so we all love to use TensorFlow. TensorFlow is our favorite. Okay, those who are fans of other, no offense, TensorFlow is my favorite. And so I very recently found out that TensorFlow has a differentially private model that performs really well if you take into consideration everything considered. And so I just wanted to touch upon what the differentially private model of TensorFlow does. And the main idea was that they trained a deep network using differentially private SGD, and then they used Moments account to track the privacy loss. In addition to that, they also had gradient clipping, mini batching, data augmentation. And a little algorithm overview of how that actually works. And I just wanted to share the results of that, because if y'all, I'm assuming most of y'all are developers, and if y'all are thinking about deploying TensorFlow in your differentially private TensorFlow in your next project or next work item, these results do matter. So there were results that were released as part of your paper on two major standard data sets. One is MNIST. If you're not aware, it is a data set of handwritten numbers. And the results are pretty good. When there's a large amount of noise, you can see that there is quite a little bit more of a difference between the differentially private and not differentially private TensorFlow. But overall, it's pretty good. Like the experiment, they used a 60-dimension PCA projection, 1,000 hidden units, and it was trained on a lot size of 600, and the clipping threshold was 4. And as you can see, the noise levels, and okay, I'm running out of time. if you're not aware, the CIFAR-10 database is a database of they have basically 60,000 32 by 32 color images in 10 classes. So the training and test error came close to the baseline of non-private deep learning methods. And to get moderate loss in performance, epsilon and delta are not negligible. And if you say, oh, I wanted too private, and you increase your epsilon too much, that's when you're going to run into trouble. When is differential privacy practical? It's best suited for population level statistics, and when something does not depend strongly on a particular individual, and large sample sizes is when you should use differential privacy. If you have a small sample size, the importance of a single data point would be more, and then it's not really advisable to use differential privacy. This is just a small, very interesting thing that I found out. So the real world application, some of the real world applications of differential privacy is that Apple has used it in iOS 10. Google has used it for sharing historical traffic statistics. Google has again used it in for their learning statistics, and U.S. Census Bureau has used it. Thank you so much for your time and attention.